Okay, so we talked about why do you personally believe in God and Jesus and all that.
And we didn't get very far.
Yeah, but you did bring up morality, that you think morality makes more sense from a Christian viewpoint than an atheist viewpoint, for example.
And we didn't even get into at all into the details.
Okay. So now you're saying you have like three other reasons?
There are other reasons. Yeah, let's see, what did I put down? The second thing is the Big Bang. And the first thing, the question then is, what caused the Big Bang? The first thing to notice about this is that it is completely separate from the question of morality. There are just two different philosophical problems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, science.
So that if you find an answer to both of them that is the same answer, the fact that your one answer solves both problems strengthens your argument. Now, well, I've heard you sometimes...
Well, I would say the morality is a philosophical question, and where did the Big Bang come from is a scientific question.
Is it a scientific question? The science said, we first learned about the Big Bang, less than 100 years ago. And so the Big Bang...
And it's our modern creation myth.
It's our modern creation myth.
Myth meaning that we don't know what's absolutely true. It's the best
but
model we have so far.
It organizes a lot of other theories, mm-hmm. right?
So it That's is the a, best it, we have so far.
It functions as a myth, but it is the best we can do. But what all scientists naturally want to ask is what caused it? Yeah, what caused the Big Bang? Mm-hmm. We run into a big problem. Because according to the Big Bang, and Einsteinian views of physics, space-time starts at the Big Bang.
I don't know if that's true or not. I don't know if there's a consensus on that.
All right, but for most people,
it sounds reasonable to me to say at least time starts there, because the infinite regress problem, that makes sense to me that time could start there.
Well, what Einstein taught us is that time and space are not different things, they are one
right,
thing, space-time.
Space right,
so
right.
space-time
space
starts at...
That's a good point.
Okay, mm-hmm. All right, so, but ordinarily we think of efficient causes as coming before. The efficient cause of this pen is I decided to move it up. That's kind of, the cause of this interview is that you invited me to come, and that happened before it. Mm-hmm. It would be really weird to say the cause of this interview was something that happened next week.
But you heard that cause and effect, it looks like it's broken on the quantum level? Have you heard that,
we have all kinds. We have, here's another problem in philosophy of science. We have two major successful research programs, quantum dynamics and relativity, that clash. And we need to get a theory of everything. Mm-hmm. Hawking is sitting there in his chair, or whatever he does, working on it, trying to come up with, it would be the holy grail of the 21st century to come up with some way to bring these two things together. Mm-hmm. Intellectual problems are great. It's wonderful. We ought to try to solve them. Mm-hmm. All right. What causes the Big Bang? If we think in terms of ordinary...
Bottom line is nobody knows, right?
Nobody knows, but it's worse than that. If you think...
How can it be worse than that? Okay.
Because you can't know unless causation is different than any form of causation we know. Efficient causation happens before the thing. So some people are saying, well, maybe the key to the cause of the Big Bang is... math, string theory. Have you heard this one?
Mm-hmm.
It's one of so that there's just something about string theory in math that causes the Big Bang. That is the current thing that we've come up with. What was the first thing that they came up with? As soon as we found out about the Big Bang, there was a very popular theory that was in all of the textbooks in the 1960s and 1970s, the oscillating universe theory. The universe explodes into being, expands and expands, and eventually it collapses on itself, and that just does it again and again, so that you don't have to ask about the cause of the Big Bang because the universe is unitary.
There is no Big Bang in that theory.
Well, not in the sense of the first Big Bang. Unfortunately, now, I'm testifying to what I've read about and cannot possibly understand.
I mean, one way I understand it, the Big Bang is... they now can see all the planets or all the galaxies moving away from each other, except for the Andromeda galaxy, which we're actually on a collision course
with.
Oh,
really? Cool.
But most galaxies are expanding, and so they're saying, let's just rewind the tape. And that's why you get to a Big Bang.
That's where we have the idea that there was a Big Bang, which was very upsetting to naturalistic philosophers, because the typical naturalist position was that the universe has always been here. You don't have to have a big beginning, it just began. Mm-hmm. Well, it never began, it's always been here. Mm-hmm. The oscillating universe theory was a way to get around it, because instead of this universe being here all the time, you just had multiple series. Mm-hmm. But Hawking and Penrose, I'm told, I couldn't do the math, have said, no, doesn't work, the formula won't work out. This universe is a one-time shot. It began at a certain time, 13.7
billion
years ago.
And how it was birthed, nobody knows, right?
And you don't even get to ask, which is very frustrating.
Well, you could probably ask, but it's just way beyond our scientific abilities right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, but notice, if there is a personal God who loves us, who creates the universe, that gives an answer.
Yeah, I mean, that's not an answer. That's just saying magic. It was done by magical beings.
All right, you can criticize it you want, but notice that the same answer gives real confidence in morality and real confidence.
But isn't that obvious? That's it. I mean, it's like.
No, it's not obvious at all. And I'm going to finish my list.
Where did humans come from?
It is not obvious at all, and I'm going to finish my list. The next one is what's called fine-tuning. When the Big Bang occurred, there are the four constants of the, I can't even remember them all. There's the strong force, the weak force, gravity, and
nuclear force, maybe?
The strong force and weak force are both nuclear forces.
Okay.
So there's one other I can't remember. Many physicists.
Magnetism, or I don't know.
Many physicists have pointed out that the four basic constants of the universe are in almost perfect alignment, and that is, you need to think of them all as having an almost infinite possibility or range of possibilities, and they all fall in a very narrow band so that we could get,
cosmological
stars.
Constants you're talking about?
The cosmological constants. The fine-tuning argument is there's a huge literature here. How is it that we got so lucky? Well, one way to answer this is multiple universes. There's been an infinite series of universes. Eventually, you got to have one you get lucky in. But that doesn't happen because Hawking says we can't.
Hawking?
Because Hawking says that, as I said
before, Hawking is not against multiverse.
He's not. It's the oscillating universe theory.
Right.
Now, so the other option, other than the oscillating universe theory, is the multiverse theory. Mm-hmm. And so, and in its full blown sense, it says, look, every time you have quantum indeterminacy, both universes come into being, so that you have an infinity of universes just created since we started having this conversation. All the possible quantum universes do exist. And so naturally, in most of them, there would not be life, but in a few of them, there is life.
I think that's a lot of detail. I think just more, it's easier just to say generically that our universe could have been birthed out of a multiverse, and what that multiverse is,
What they usually do is they say all possible universes do exist, and naturally then, there's going to be a tiny minority of them. But of course, we would evolve in the tiny minority. So, problem solved. Mm-hmm. Except these unknown universes are just as mysterious and just as a matter of faith as believing in God.
Just because the science is so far out there, we don't have the ability for it.
You think that? No, it's not that way.
This is
if they are multiverses, science explores this universe. It cannot explore universes outside of this one.
Well, some people have claimed that there's no way to test whether there's a multiverse out there. But some scientists have come up with creative things. Like, for example, mm-hmm. they say if there is a multiverse, if that's really true, we might see in the background radiation, we might see
test for it.
Yeah, we might see some bruising, because we might be hitting another universe and it'll show some bruise marks or something.
Okay.
And they've actually looked
for
those.
If it turns out to be a way of testing it, then that would be really cool. That would be good.
And that's very creative thinking, because, you know, off the top of the head, some people said, well, there's no way to test it, therefore it's not science. But then they do think of ways.
We're down to about a minute. The last one is, what is
so you're saying for you personally, that's compelling?
The combination that God explains these very important questions, it is compelling.
I don't think it's explaining. I think it's just magic, appeal to magic. So, okay.
Why does evolution produce human beings that have reliable cognitive faculties?
Sometimes they aren't. Sometimes there's optical illusions and things.
That's right.
But we learn from science what those are and try to take those into account.
No, I think the only consistent answer is that evolution produces cognitive faculties that help us reproduce. That's all it does.
Yeah, sure.
And so if billions
survival
of people...
Survival of the fittest is part of that reproductive.
Right, but that's the whole idea.
Warfare.
The idea of what they call natural selection. there is no purpose to it. It's just a selection. The selection is for whatever works. And intelligence for human beings has worked. Non-intelligence for bacteria has worked even better.
Well, it's not just humans. I mean, chimps and elephants, they migrate, and chimps have warfare and tribal things. Mm-hmm, I mean, they all have to use some intelligence, even for mating. There's mating dances.
Yeah,
and
so
stuff.
Intelligence, we think intelligence is really cool.
Animals do too. Like even using deception, animals use deception.
All right.
Stuff.
Is there anything in intelligence that leads to truth? It leads to, so far, reproductive success.
Yeah.
But
and warfare requires truth, because you know, if you want to deceive your enemy, you need to know what the truth is. And if you want to develop nuclear technology for nuclear bombs, that needs to be based in truth.
So 500 years from now, after we have used our bombs, and there are no intelligent beings on Earth.
You mean no chimps or anything? No whales or anything?
Yeah, well, if we use them, probably the best.
Back to bacteria again?
You know, bacteria, maybe cockroaches, they say. Okay. The cockroaches win the war.
Okay.
What should we say about evolution then?
That's just a setback. I mean, as far as we're concerned, but life's always changing.
Life is always changing.
I mean, right now
changing.
It's evolving.
It's
life's
changing.
Evolving even right now at this point.
It's always evolving.
Mm-hmm.
It's always changing, but not toward a goal.
Right. Right.
So the goal of evolution was not to create intelligence.
Right.
So the goal of evolution was just to get us to a position where we can reproduce our genes.
Dominate your niche or so, yeah. Mm-hmm. Like we are the best at thinking, but we're not the best at flying or the best at swimming.
That's right. And so the best at thinking does not give us true beliefs. Look, most people on Earth believe in God. It must be a mistake.
But I think true beliefs are a matter of survival.
Are they?
Yeah, because when you go to war,
when it comes to religion, the real true belief,
if we go to war with China, like if we go to war with China or Russia, if we have the true beliefs, we can, you know, that's why we develop science and they try to weaponize all the science and everything right off the bat.
So, true beliefs are evolutionarily successful, and that's why we get them.
I think so.
Then why do people get bad, false beliefs?
They're the ones who become food usually. The ones who have the false beliefs are the ones who people. You know, they use them to get what they want. If you're a dumb person, you'll work for less wage than what you deserve.
The point here is very straightforward.
You'll have to summarize. We're going to be out of time, so I'll give you a minute to summarize this.
Success in natural selection is success in reproduction. It is not success in gaining the truth. So we should not be, if you believe in evolution, which of course I do, and if you believe in naturalism, which of course you do, then you should have no confidence in your cognitive capacities because they are not evolved for truth, they've evolved for success. Success is not truth.
Well,
it's just a different thing.
Well, survival though too.
No, the survival is survival of our genes.
We need the truth in order to survive in a war with China or Russia or anybody else.
We don't.
We do, because
if that's true, then why do the bacteria win?
They don't win.
They do win. If we have the war, they win, because they're going to still be here.
Well, right, there's bacteria in the body, and we develop pills to kill the bacteria. So
yeah, we try to kill them, but we lose all the time. The bacteria on Earth outweigh us. They don't just outnumber us, they outweigh us.
Someday, I believe, we're going to create the machine life and the robots, and they're going to be the dominant force, and we're going to be their little monkeys anyway.
All right. Well, we went way over time. Thank you for watching, if anybody's still there.
Okay, Phil.
Thank you.
Thanks for being on the show. Really appreciate it.